And now we are going live. And now we are live on Facebook. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to today's session. I am Ishan Sharma, founder of Carvan, the Heritage Exploration Initiative. And today's Carvan special lecture is on Beyond the Blood and Fury, Revisiting the Colonial Indian Army. To talk about this very interesting topic, and I think it is the first in the series of the military history of India, we have Professor Sabyasachi Das Gupta with us, joining us from Vishwa Bharati University, where he's currently an assistant professor, I'm really sorry, at the Department of History at Vishwa Bharati University, Shanti Niketan, West Bengal. He is the author of numerous books and articles, including In Defense of Honor and Justice, Sepoy Rebellions in the 19th Century, Durga Das and Sita Ram, Tales of Loyalty in 1857, The Marathas in 1803, Effort Power or Unlucky Losers, that was published in the Indian Historical Review, In Quest of Identity, Sepoy Rebellions in the 19th Century in Jadavpur University Journal of History, and among many others. He was also the Charles Wallace Visiting Fellow in 2012 to the Institute for Advanced Studies in the Humanities and the Center for South Asian Studies at University of Edinburgh. So we are definitely very fortunate to have Professor Das Gupta with us this evening to deliver this lecture. Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invitation, and over to you. You have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. And first of all, I would like to thank Ishan and the Carva Initiative for letting me speak. It's an honor for me also. And I have a bias or I have a soft corner for such platforms, because when we were in JNU, we founded the History Association. Professor Harbans Mukherjee here would recall that. And once I actually sort of sabotaged his class to ensure that the 60 people he was holding in his class come to the convocation room to hear this. Here the panel discussion. Anyway, so those of you who have tried such initiatives know how difficult it is. So keep going. Now I will talk about my topic. If you notice the title, it is Beyond the Blood and Fury, Revisiting the Colonial Indian Army. So I have given this title intentionally. Initially, I wanted to speak on visualizing 1857, but Gohar Raja has already spoken on 1857. So I decided that I shall speak in general about my work. And why I have given the title Revisiting the Indian Army is because I will not speak per se about battles and wars, okay, or the battles and wars the colonial Indian Army fought. What I will try to do is that I will try to trace the social history of the native recruit in the infantry regiments of the British Indian Army or the Colonial Indian Army. Now, why do I say the infantry regiments of the British Indian Army or the Colonial Indian Army, or whatever you say? That's because the British, the European armies, right from the medieval times, because of certain changes or military developments, like change in tactics, the coming of parade drill, the return of the importance of infantry, starting from around the 14th century or the 15th century. There is a debate regarding this between Geoffrey Parker and Michael Roberts. So right from the 14th century onwards, the European armies were getting infantry heavy. Like, there was now again an emphasis on disciplined infantry formations, fighting in square, line, column, or in a disciplined formation. And this had also possibly something to do with also the transition from feudalism to capitalism, though it was a long transition. And you know, in the feudal society, the mounted trooper or the knight had a social prestige. And now with the transition, there was also some certain developments where new tactics were being pursued. So by the time the British came to India, most European armies were infantry heavy, which is not to say that cavalry had disappeared. Cavalry was still important, and cavalry was used as shock troops to charge the enemy at some weak point or at some vital moments in a battle. You know, the cavalry was used. Napoleon used to do that, and a host of other Western generals. But by the time the English came to India, the army was infantry heavy. To give you an example, the Bengal army, in reality, actually till the mid 1890s, I think till 1895, there were three colonial armies. Actually, one was the Bengal army, corresponding to the Bengal presidency. One was the Madras army, and one was the Bombay army. The Bengal army was the largest, and the Bombay army was the smallest. And the commander-in-chief of the Bengal army was the total commander-in-chief of the English East India Company troops till 1857. Now, to give you an example, the Bengal army had about 74 infantry regiments around 1857, while they had around 20 cavalry regiments. So these statistics are just meant to show that the Bengal army or the colonial Indian armies or the Western armies, because these colonial Indian armies were modeled on majorly on the Western armies, they were infantry heavy. So that is why today my story about the British Indian Army is limited to the infantry. The cavalry, I shall speak some other day, somewhere. Now, what do I mean exactly by the social history of the Indian Army? What I mean is that I will try to raise issues of identity, notions of honor and justice, deference, resistance, paternalism, and a host of other issues. And what I'm trying to do is that, because enough has been spoken on 1857, I will try to focus on the local mutinies, like the Vellore mutiny, the Barakpur mutiny, and some other mutinies. And I am trying to go beyond the usual binaries of discipline and indiscipline. First of all, I remember when I was doing my PhD under Professor Niladri Bhattacharya, every time I tried to write that the colonial, the native recruit was indisciplined or something like that, he said that why should you as an Indian write that they were indisciplined, write decent. So I am going here beyond the binaries of discipline and indiscipline. And what I'm trying to say is that that there were these notions of honor, around these notions of honor and justice, particularly, deference was conditional, especially in the Bengal army and in the early Madras army. And these mutinies, starting from the Vellore mutiny, were some kind of, you could say, violent negotiation, where terms of contract were being renegotiated. And a host of issues were being played around these mutinies, issues which I've just mentioned, like of identity, of the corporate identity of the sepoy, and notions of honor and justice, deference, resistance. Host of issues were being played around these mutinies. And what I'm trying to do is that I'm using these mutinies as an entry point into the day-to-day life of the sepoy and into the wider social world of the sepoy. And my objective is basically, if I would state it slightly more clearly, my objective is to look at the army and the colonial Indian army in its wider social setting. You know, I basically want to look at the flux generated by the army in native society or from in its parent society, and both ways around. And then also how the discourses pertaining to the army are also being influenced by discourses generated in the civilian society, both ways. So what I'm trying to pitch for here is that, well, I have no issue with people who do campaign histories or hardcore military history, and I would like to study the colonial Indian Army in a wider setting, because I think there are very important links to various other disciplines as far as the military history of colonial India is concerned. And Radhika Singer's book, which is just out, The Coolies, the book that basically tries, is a very good example, recent example of that kind of history. Now, as I said, that I would like to start, I would just concentrate on the local mutinies. So the first local mutiny which happened was in Vellore in 1806. Before I go into the Vellore mutiny, it would be pertinent to speak a bit about the recruitment policy of the Madras Army. Now, firstly, one must say that as far as the infantry regiments were concerned, there were every native Indian had to join as a sepoy, as in you were, there was no commissioned Indian officer, the kind like captain, major, lieutenant, colonel. These were all European officers. Okay, the all commissioned officers were Europeans. So everybody had to join as a sepoy. From a sepoy, you became a naik. From a naik, you became a havildar, jemedar, and then a subedar, and initially a subedar major. By the time you became a subedar, you were usually 60 and hardly fit to hold a gun. And this promotion was slow, and it varied slightly between the three armies, but not by much. So this was the basic system of recruitment. Now, the Madras army was initially composed of higher caste, local South Indian higher caste, and Purbaiyas, as in recruits from high caste recruits from modern day Eastern UP and Bihar, who were also recruited. Now, then the Madras army felt that the high caste recruits were very problematic when it came to religious beliefs. Now, look here, one could see a typically Orientalist cliche that Asiatics or Indians were very, very sensitive when it came to matters of religion. So this is so they believe, and especially if as far as Indians were concerned, if they were higher caste. So after initial preference for higher caste, the Madras army stuck to middle castes and lower castes, but excluding some lower caste who were required for agricultural labor. So there were certain so-called lower castes which were mentioned by name, that these four or five castes will not be taken into the army because they are needed for agricultural labor. So this was the way they recruited. Now, another thing which was present in the Madras army, right from the beginning, they were also on a Europeanizing drive. What I mean by a Europeanizing drive was what I mean is that they were trying to, right from the beginning, they were trying to clothe the sepoy in European clothing. As in, initially, the sepoys wore a kacha or Indian style, you could say langoti or whatever, but the red coat on top. But Indian officers, as in right starting from Havildar, had to wear the trousers and the red coat right from the beginning. From the 1790s onwards, all Indian recruits had to wear I could show also a picture. Just a minute. I'll show pictures of certain. See. This is a Madras sepoy, a watercolor painting of the Madras sepoy in the 1780s. As you can see, he's wearing a langoti and the red coat upstairs. And he's probably off duty because he's wearing chappals. This is his wife. So this is the early times around 1780. Okay, around 1780s. But even in the 1780s, the sepoy officers have to be in trousers and red coats. I'll show you another picture. This one are is a slightly later picture in the 19th century. These are all sepoy officers. Now this one in the blue jacket or the blue top, he is the artillery officer. Well, these are infantry officers. And finally, the one which was also part of my poster, this one. Here, this is again an artillery Golandas. This is a sepoy. He's not wearing trousers. Okay, he's wearing the red coat and he's wearing, you could say, whatever you call langoti or whatever. This is a sepoy officer dressed quite regally, you know, wearing boots, trousers, and red coat. So this was the, I'll stop sharing now. Wait just a minute. I'm slightly, where has it gone? Oh, stop sharing, it's upstairs. Right, I'm back. Okay. So this was the policy as far as uniforms were concerned. Now the Madras Army had another characteristics. There, apart from middle caste and lower caste Hindus, they recruited a large number of Muslims, around 30%. Now this was unique because the other infantry regiments in the Bengal Army and the Bombay Army did not have Muslims in the infantry regiments. The cavalry had a large number of Muslims. So what used to happen is that initially, many of the Hindu soldiers of the Madras Army used to sport caste marks, as in, you know, you have seen often this caste marks. And many of the Muslim soldiers used to sort of sport whiskers on parade. So this was, in course of time, this was sort of prohibited. But though this was prohibited, the order was not uniformly followed. Some regiments sort of strictly prohibited the wearing of whiskers and caste marks on parade, while some did not do so. It all depended on the local, on the rapport of the, or the understanding between the British officers and the sepoys. Now around, just let me switch on the fan. It's quite hot in Kolkata. Now, around 1806, certain regulations were imposed, which said that from now on, all these whiskers and parades are strictly prohibited. And there was also a new turban issued, which looked like the headgear of half of the Portuguese drummers. Now this caused a lot of tension. Now, why did this headgear cause a lot of tension? Now these drummers who were of Portuguese and half Indian origin were usually the products of the union between so-called lowly Indian women and lowly Portuguese. So even the middle caste and the lower caste sepoys used to look upon them as half caste. So they were very resentful of the turbans, and also they were resentful of the whiskers, the order prohibiting whiskers and parade, caste marks. So trouble now gradually started erupting, and matters were possibly not helped by the fact that the Tipu Sultan's family was stationed in the fort at Vellore. So gradually for 2-3 months, sepoys started saying that we will not take this new headgear. If we take this new headgear, we will lose our caste. Nobody will marry our daughters. Nobody will give us water. And they were also protesting against the whiskers and parade. Finally, after a period of 3 months, on 10th of July, 1806, the first big mutiny in the Indian Army, in the colonial Indian Army, broke out, where there was actual fighting. And the British were only saved because somehow word got around to Arcot, which is nearby Vellore, and a detachment under Colonel Gillespie came and defeated the rebels. And it was a huge rebellion in the sense that 2,500 soldiers were involved in Vellore. And along with Vellore, there were trouble noted in various other places of South India like Hyderabad, Palamkotta, Walajahad. But luckily for the British, before things could really break out in a big way, all these disturbances were nipped in the bud. So you could say in one sense that, you know, if the luck had gone slightly on in the way of the towards the, or you could say in favor of the rebels, the first big rebellion, coordinated rebellion, could have happened in 1896, at least in a large number of places in South India. And who knows, from South India, it could have spread to the other parts of India. Now, the point is that the rebellion didn't succeed and it was crushed. Now, who was the governor of the Vellore, the Madras Presidency, when the rebellion broke out? It was a young William Bentinck, whose career was almost destroyed by this rebellion. Now, this rebellion, mutiny, raised a host of questions. Firstly, as I mentioned, that most of the India, the commissioned officers were Europeans. And again, in a typical Orientist cliche, the British believed that if Indians have to be governed or Asiatics have to be governed, the mode of command has to be despotic. It has to be a Maibab style command. So initially, the European officers were given a host of powers, a lot of discretionary powers, whereas they could punish, they could reward, they could punish without, you know, reference to higher authority. They could deliver major punishments without reference to court martial. So a host of powers, because, and a host of allowances, because they wanted to build up the image of a Maibab, as in the European officer is a Maibab, is your father. He is like your father, who will reward you if you do good things, and he will punish you, including physical beatings, if you do something which they do not like. And this kind of command continued till 1795. This was also the time when Europeans or European men mixed more with the native society, which does not obviously mean that they mixed on an equal footing. They knew the native languages possibly better in these early stages. So this was the style of command which went till 1796, when changes came and a more impersonal mode of command came into being, which was much more bureaucratized, because the violence was getting out of hand. There were too many instances of these so-called paternal officers inflicting arbitrary violence on the sepoy recruits. Now, if you look at the inquiry commission and then and the deliberations between William Bentinck and the commander in chief of the Vellore, the Madras Army, which was a certain James Craddock, they're continuously saying that, you know, in the old good old days when things were fine, when our officers were like the father for children, were like fathers to the sepoys, and the sepoys were like the children, everything was fine. Now this new kind of bureaucratized command system has come and everything has gone haywire and they do not mix with them any longer. So this kind of, you know, discourse we could see. Now, and also the Bentinck is saying that the Asiatic soldier, his notion of discipline is not the same as that of the European notion of European soldier's notion of discipline. You cannot apply the same methods, standards, or the same standards as you do for European soldiers. You cannot enforce the same code of discipline as you do for the European soldiers. The Asiatic soldier's mode of discipline is different. He is very sensitive in matters of religion, and Bentinck felt that they were justified in getting angry because the colonial government was playing around with the religion. Of course, they were not justified. He never said that they were justified in mutinying, but he definitely said that they were justified in getting angry. So anyway, the long and short of it was that the Bentinck gave amnesty to those who were not involved in serious crimes, and for that was recalled to England. Long and short of it was that Madras government withdrew that offensive headgear. Madras government withdrew the order which banned the sporting of whiskers and caste marks on parade. So the soldiers, in a way, won a victory, a pyrrhic victory, a very costly victory, but they did win a victory. After this incident in 1806, there was a scare in Quilon in 1812 when a local Raja was apparently, disaffected local Raja was conspiring with this native garrison there, but that was also, that fizzled out. After that, between 1806 and 1857, the Madras army, barring some disturbances when they were on service in Sindh, which was not very serious, never again sort of evinced any signs of disaffection. And one could say that the colonial government succeeded in building a corporate identity of the sepoy. Now, what do I mean by the corporate identity of the sepoy? By corporate identity of the sepoy, what I mean is that the Madras government is trying to build a distinct identity of the sepoy, whereas he feels, you know, himself distinct from his parent society. He stops identifying himself with the aspirations, fears, hopes of his parent society or the disaffection in his parent society, and feels empowered by his identity as a East India Company soldier. They sort of initiated a host of measures. For instance, they now said that if a soldier fights well or should commits or some act of bravery, he will be allowed to go to his village in a palki, as palki is the Bengali word, is a palanquin, or I think most of you understand what I mean. Now, you must remember that most of the soldiers, especially the Hindu soldiers, are so-called middle caste or lower caste. The palki or the palanquin in those days in the 19th century is a mark of prestige. Everybody cannot ride in a palki or a palanquin. Only notables in the village or notables in society can ride. So, you know, so-called middle caste or a lower caste soldier can ride to his village or go back to his village in a palki means a huge thing. So they initiated a lot of measures, likewise other measures. There are a lot of allowances, a lot of privileges like riding in a palki. And one would say that they succeeded in building constructing a corporate identity of the Madras sepoy, because between 1812, if I consider the scare at Quilon, and 1857, there were quite a few Moplah rebellions, okay, big and small. There were at least 30% of the Madras army was Muslim. Not a single soldier deserted or went to the side of the Moplah rebellion. There were a series of campaigns against local polygars and chiefs. The Madras army took a very active part in putting these chiefs down. So one would say that the Madras army after 1812 showed no interest in the disaffection in civilian society or in the parent society, and possibly the privileges and the honors which the company bestowed on them now sort of empowered especially the middle and the lower caste sepoys, who now could, using their identity as an East India Company soldier, projecting their uniform as the East India Company soldier, could aspire to a status which they possibly could not have acquired unless they were East India Company soldiers, or but for the fact that they were East India Company soldiers. So Vellore was the beginning and the end as far as mutinies in the Madras army was concerned. The Quilon one fizzled out, so I won't consider it as a mutiny which actually took place. We now so there is no link between, you see, 18 the Madras army within the Vellore mutiny and 1857. But there are some issues which the Vellore mutiny threw up. The issues of relative discipline, the issues of maybe honor and justice centered around religion and partly on economic incentives, the issue of religion, the issue of paternalism, paternal mode of command, whether the paternal mode of command is best suited to command Indians. These are certain issues which the mutiny threw up. And these the issues which would resonate later, especially in the Bengal Army. Now, coming to the Bengal Army, the army which ultimately broke down in 1857, and broke down in the sense as in out of 74, 61 regiments mutinied, only 13 regiments remained loyal, including some crucially at Lucknow. So this, how was this army composed? Now, this army was a very, very upper caste army, as in they were composed at least in the 1830s, predominantly, overwhelmingly of Purbaiyas, as in upper caste Hindu men hailing from a middle farmer background from what would be roughly today's Eastern UP and Bihar, Purba, and they were called Purbaiyas. And why did the army recruit this man? Now, the men in charge of the Bengal army had these romantic notions that this man corresponded to what was the yeoman farmer in England. As in, before the Industrial Revolution set in, it was said that the English army, or the bulk and rank and file of the English army, or the bulk of the English army, was composed of men from the yeoman farmer, who were very brave fighters, loyal, obedient, and brave fighters. And this upper caste men hailing from a middle farmer background corresponded to this yeoman farmer. These men were supposedly taught from childhood to be brave, loyal, and obedient. Now, one thing, it's a cliched joke, but I have to still say it, the Bengal presidency had no Bengalis. So, because they were considered cowardly, the Bengali men. So this is also important because, you know, we have read Mrinalini Sinha and how the Bengali Babu was sort of classified as cowardly post 1857, because the Babu was getting disaffected post 1857, when the fruits of the British rule, which he hoped would come his way or the way of the Indians, were not coming. And now the Bengali Babu was classified as cowardly. And Mrinalini Sinha's entire argument that was one of the reasons why a section of the Bengali male was into, gymnasiums, bodybuilding, what we call in Bengali lathi khela, and a lot of other physical, activities involving physical exercise. And possibly that was also one of the motivating factors for a lot of Bengalis to become revolutionaries, to show that they were capable of physical bravery. Now, this is the post 1850s, but around this time, 1757 and onwards, we see that there was no class or religious factor. The Bengali, whether irrespective of his class or religion, was considered cowardly. Now, why they were considered cowardly? How did this notion arise in the first place? One has no idea. I have a feeling that it was partly because somehow this was an, you could say, as Kaushik Rai has said, this was what he said was a selective enlistment theory, or an early version of the martial race theory, which would come up in the 1880s. Now, I personally, though I have not yet developed this argument, I'm trying to develop this argument, I believe that the martial race theory had also native inputs, as in which communities were classified as brave or martial, and which communities were classified as unmartial, also depended a lot on the native perception of the native perception, or the perception of native communities about each other. So that also influenced the British perception about certain communities. So, or it could be the other way around also, but this is a distinct possibility. So anyway, the long and short of it again is that there were no Bengalis in the Bengal army. Now, this high caste Purbaiyas, right from the beginning, they were that the very high caste ethos developed in the Bengal army, as in the policymakers in charge of the Bengal armies, both civilian and military, believed again in the Orientalist stereotype, cliched, whatever you say, that the Indian, especially the high caste Indian, was very, very sensitive when it came to matters of religion. So the upper caste sipoy, Purvaya, had a high caste diet. It was optional for him to cross sea, on because he, as you know, that there was this belief among Hindus that, you know, if you cross, go by sea overseas, you lose your caste. So it was optional till 1856. So he could refuse overseas expeditions. And if he agreed, then you had to load the food and the Ganga Jal in front of him. And suppose once a British officer or anybody passed by the food containers wearing a leather belt, then you had to throw the entire food. So there was this entire high caste ethos in the Bengal army. And what I have argued elsewhere and before also is that it led to a certain conditional deference, in the sense that there were certain notions of honor and justice, or there were certain honor and justice. This conditional deference was centered around honor and justice. If the colonial army hurt his honor or did something which they considered unjust, the Bengal sepoy did not consider it fit anymore or necessary anymore to follow the British officer or to obey the British officer. So this was some kind of a conditional deference. And now conditional deference is, so in writing or in as far as do writing cannot be there in any military army, but this is what the actual culture on the ground was. Now this conditional deference on the part of the Bengal soldier was very different, or the Purbaya, or the real leeway given to his religious beliefs. And also this entire thing was also that he was being given a lot of leeway. On top of that, the way he was being recruited, that if somebody was there in the army, let's say a jemedar or a subedar, when he went home, he brought back his relatives. So entire, what was happening was that this entire army was a very, very closed army where everybody knew everybody. And to an extent, civilian life was being replicated here, the life you lived as a civilian, because your religious beliefs, which you held in your civilian life, you are being allowed to your religious practices, you are being allowed to hold them here too. And it is because of the manner of recruitment, everybody knew each other. But the striking thing is that this Purbaya was recruited in large numbers in also the Bombay army. Now the Bombay army was a mixed army, but it contained a large number of Purbayas, about 35%, and 40%, let's say, Marathas, and then Konkani Jews and other communities. And the way the Purbaya was treated in the Bombay army was in complete contrast to that of the Bengal army. Right from the beginning, the Purbaya in the Bombay army, it was made very clear to him that we respect your religious beliefs, but if the military duty and religious beliefs come into conflict, you cannot. How much time do I have, Eshan?
So we have around half an hour.
Okay. So if the religious beliefs and military duties come into conflict, military duties will always take precedence. You cannot refuse to serve or give guard, sentry guard with a so-called lower caste soldier. You cannot refuse to sleep in the same tent as a lower caste soldier, or not to dig trenches saying that you are high caste and you are not to do such things, or to refuse overseas service. So there is no conditional deference here. There is, right from the beginning, insistence on unconditional obedience. And now the point is, so the Purbaya is being treated very differently in the Bombay army. And there are these tales where a Purbaya soldier is cooking with his belt on, and somebody asked him that, how come you are cooking with your belt on, because the belt is leather and it is polluting. And he's saying, kya karu sir, mulk ka dastur hai, which is to say that in the Bombay army, it was politic for a put by a soldier to pretend or to show that he was flexible if it came when it came to matters of religion. Because if the authorities got wind that this is a particularly difficult Purbaya soldier who is very, very super sensitive about his religious beliefs, he might not be drafted in. So it was in your interest to show that you are flexible when it comes to religious observances. Now the point is, which I am again working on, that how, firstly, it's very obvious and I hardly need stated that colonial discourses, I'm not making any profound point here, a lot of people have made it before me, colonial discourse was hardly homogeneous, it was heterogeneous. As we can see that the same set of soldiers are being treated in different ways in the Bengal presidency and in the Bombay presidency, as in the Purbayas. Now, so it is obvious that the policymakers of the Bombay army held different beliefs. Now, the regarding caste and its caste and religious beliefs and the sensitivity of Indians. Now, why was the discourse different in Bombay or in the Bombay presidency? Why was the Purbaya treated different in the Bombay presidency in the first place? Now, again, these are works I'm doing, or these are new areas which I have taken up and I am in the process of working. So I cannot give definitive answers at this point of time. I can only hazard certain guesses. One is that the Purbaya was in considerable numbers, but he was not in a brute majority as in the Bengal army, in the sense that they were always around 35% of the Bombay army. In the Bengal army before the 1830s, they used to be around 80%. And the Purbaya also was operating away from his home base. As in the Bengal presidency of the Bengal army, it was an army which was near to their homes and it was sort of their home ground. Whereas the Purbayas who are going from to the Bombay presidency are operating far away from their home ground. So to bargain or to to be assertive takes a lot more doing in the Bombay presidency than in the Bengal presidency. Also, it could also happen, and this again I'm hazarding a guess, that the kind of society which the policymakers of the Bombay army, both civilian and military, encountered in the Bombay presidency was much more flexible and less rigid, where maybe possibly identities and beliefs were more fluid. So since they encountered this kind of a society, they were prepared to believe, or they were prepared to sort of believe that, we can afford to insist with the Purbayas that you cannot cite religious sentiment to refuse any kind of military duty. Whereas it is possible that the policymakers of the Bengal army met a much more rigid and codified society in the Bengal presidency, where religious identities or religious beliefs were much more rigid and tightly set. So they started believing that one should not take any chances as far as the religious beliefs of the Purbayas or the high caste sepoys are concerned, because the Asiatic is very, very sensitive and rigid when it comes to matters of religion. Now, this is something, if you ask me, what do I have a proof? I do not have a proof at the moment. This is something I'm working on, and I need to study again, as I'm talking about, as is the objective of my talk, and it is very, very obvious. The military history is never just military history. Military history can only flower, or military history can only be possibly written in a more meaningful way when you sort of collaborate and straddle across disciplines or across boundaries. So anyway, now this is the way the Bengal army treated the Purbaya, and this is the way the Bombay army treated the Purbaya. Now, what was the outcome? Now, let's look at the outcome. The Bombay army, actually, they were about in the smallest army of the three, there were about 29 regiments, out of which actually 5 mutinied in 1857. Now, there are 2 ways of saying that the Bombay army insisted on complete obedience, but they did rebel in 1857. Now, I can also say that, you know, if only 5 regiments out of 24 mutiny, that means that 2/3 of the army remain loyal. And the mutiny was led in the 1857. Mutiny happened in places like Karachi, Kolhapur, Satara, places like, and the mutiny was led both by Maratha sepoys and Purbaya sepoys, but they were put down. What happened to the Bengal army? We all know it completely collapsed. It was almost, because if 61 regiments mutiny, then nothing is left of your army. Now, does that mean that the Bengal army, the ethos of the Bengal army was, ill-suited to ensure loyalty, or the Bengal army was an indisciplined army in quotes, or it had some kind of a long-term decline? I take a line that there was no long-term cause for 1850, the Bengal army disintegrating in 1857. Let us look at one mutiny in the Barakpur mutiny, in the Bengal army, to dwell on this point further. Around 1824, there was a mutiny at Barakpur. Now, the case lay that the Burma war was going on, and some regiments had arrived from Mathura to Barakpur, and they were supposed to then go onwards to Rangoon. Now, the usual practice in the company armies was that if you sort of wanted the sepoys to march, you had to provide them the bullocks and the carriages. They were not supposed to procure it themselves. Now, for 1848, for some reason, at that point of time, there was a shortage of bullocks and carriages. And the company said that the sepoys have to arrange their own bullocks and own carriages. Now this, the sepoys found it terribly unjust, and it disturbed their notion of justice, because they believed that it was their due to expect that the company provide them with carriages and bullocks. Now on top of that, their commanding officer, Cartwright, was an unpopular officer. One, he used to abuse on parade and used to talk to his soldier officers, men roughly. He was a new generation officer. As I mentioned earlier in my talk, that there was a transition from the personal mode of command to an impersonal mode of command, more bureaucratic mode of command. Now, the point is that in the earlier mode of command, in the paternal mode of command, while abuses undoubtedly took place, interaction, close interaction, occasional shows of affection could couch a lot of abuses at times. But in the new system, that if you were aloof and did not mix, and on top of that abuse, there was no buffer. It was not that Cartwright was not efficient in his own sense. He actually went to Kolkata when he saw the situation to procure bullocks and carriages for the sepoys, or to negotiate with the military authorities and the civilian authorities in Calcutta then. And then when he failed, he offered the sepoys 4,000 rupees from his, which is a considerable sum in those areas, in those times, for hiring bullocks and carriages. But Cartwright was so unpopular, and Cartwright was also accused of nepotism, that the sepoys did not listen to him. But unlike the Vellore mutiny, they did not commit any active violence. Their protest was limited to disorderly behavior or chaotic behavior on parade. Like they used to come on parade and shout and whistle, tear the regimental flags and stomp their foot. Non-violent protest in a sense. Finally, on 1st November 1824, troops arrived from Calcutta, surrounded the mutineers in Barakpur, and massacred them to a man. And this was a cold-blooded massacre, because these people had not attacked, killed, wounded, or remotely touched any British soldier or any British officer. So this was as cold-blooded a massacre as you can get. Actually, the movie Mangal Pandey shows this massacre. Anyway, so Now, what could one, this was the first, you could say, this was the second mutiny in the Bengal army. There was also a mutiny in Java, where they went to Java, agreed to go to Java, because the authorities provided them allowances, extra allowances. And then they revolted, saying that we have been not promised what we got. But the point is that lot of these historians like Saul David, Amiya Bharat, they sort of argue that the Bengal army was an indisciplined army. It was where a long-term problem of indiscipline, and things were getting worse and worse. And a conflagration or an explosion like 1857 was bound to happen one day. So the core of their argument, basically they're arguing in a nutshell, is that the Bengal army was plagued by endemic problems of indiscipline, okay? By endemic indiscipline, by chronic indiscipline. And this indiscipline was increasing day by day. And something like 1857 was bound to happen. It was basically a long-term culmination of basic fundamental disciplinary problems in the Bengal army. Now, this is a slightly difficult to digest, because on one notion, there are certain issues. Again, the Barakpur mutiny, again, if you look at the proceedings in the National Archives of Delhi, you will see the same old story about how our officers were like fathers before to the sepoys, and now they don't mix, and so all these problems are arising. Those same old stories of a paternal mode of command, which was just supposedly a golden period for the British armies, and now this new impersonal bureaucratic mode of command, which has destroyed everything. Firstly, if you look at statistics, deterioration after the transition to an impersonal mode of command cannot be borne out, the case for a deterioration. Because what are the statistics? If you look at court martial records, if you look at things like desertion, disobedience, theft, robber, killing, you know, if you look at such, day-to-day discipline, the day-to-day disciplines record of the Bengal armies or of the Madras armies or of the Bombay armies did not deteriorate after the transition to an impersonal mode of command. You could always say the statistics are, you know, the statistics do not say anything. Now, that is true. The statistics don't say everything. But if statistics or if instances of dissent, I have noticed that I've quite a few times used the word indiscipline here. If the instances of dissent needed to be suppressed, it would probably happen more in the days when there was a paternal mode of command, because the commanding officer or the officer on the ground had so much discretionary powers that he could always easily hide an offense, not register it, solve it in through some kind of a panchayat meeting, and not show it on record. Whereas in the later stage, when things have become bureaucratized, it's slightly more difficult to hide if any extraordinary incident has occurred. So firstly, this entire thing of this paternal, the golden days of paternal, this is a racist notion which needs to be registered. This is the, you could say the Victorian British, this romantic notion that this brave, magnificent British officer leading these childlike natives, you know, this entire racist notion is associated with this emphasis that the paternal age was a great age where things were hunky-dory, and when there was a transition to a more impersonal mode of command, things deteriorated. It is not borne out by statistics. Secondly, the Bengal sepoy, it is true that there was some kind of a conditional deference, and there were times when there were trouble regarding where his notions of honor and justice were hurt or trifled with, and he rose to in collective dissent. But between such instances, let's say 1811, he mutinied. 1824, he mutinied. 1840, there was trouble in Sindh. But between these instances, if you look at the periods in between them, between 1811 to 1840, the Bengal army's day-to-day disciplinary record is actually much better than that of the Bombay army and the Madras army, two armies which were supposedly loyal in 1857. The Bombay Army mutinied partly. The Madras Army did not mutiny at all. So if one were to draw a linear teleology or sought to draw a linear teleology of continuous trouble, continuous problems, continuous so-called indiscipline culminating in 1857, how does one explain the period, the long periods of calm between two or three instances of collective dissent? How does one explain the periods in between? Because there was also a lot going for the Bengal sepoy. It is true that he had his problems. It is true that because of the manner of recruitment, his contact with the civilian society was he had active contact with the civilian society, because it was an army where a lot of the practices you followed when you were a civilian, you follow in the army. The army is like a Chacha Bhatija army. Every second person knows everybody, because it is an army where when you go back home for your yearly furlough or holiday, you bring back some relative, either your nephew or your son or your neighbor. So it is true that these things bred some kind of a closed shop system. But also one must remember that they also derive a sense of power from their service as the East India Company soldier. You must remember that these are high caste, but these are not sort of high, you could say, upper class, as in they're middle farmers. They're not the zamindars of their village. So the East India, but now their service as an East India Company soldier is giving them a source of some sort of identity. When he's coming with these uniforms, which I showed, and he's coming with them to the village, it is a sort of a power projection, because that uniform means that he is the soldier in the East India Company, which by the 1810 is the paramount power in the subcontinent, with the possibly the exception of the Sikhs, whom they are yet to defeat. Okay. So now his identity as a East India Company soldier allows him to sort of take on maybe the zamindar, not always successfully, but at times successfully. This is something which he could not have envisioned before. So, of course, he is suffering from economic distress. The sepoy used to get 7 rupees per month. By the time he became a subedar, he used to get 60 rupees per month. But if one were to look at the prices between, let's say, 1796 to 1850, prices of wheat, dal, you know, the essential rice, they rose by 7-8 times, whereas the sepoy's salary hardly rose, or maybe just rose by 1 or 2 times, not more than that. So his real income declined. But I am arguing that the prestige which accrued to him as an East India Company soldier compensated for this loss for this economic decline. So what I'm arguing is that while the Bengal Army had a certain ethic, a certain culture of conditional deference, which led to trouble occasionally, instances of collective dissent, the Bengal sepoy was far from being totally discontented. He had a lot to gain from the army. And while he, like the Madras sepoy, possibly never severed his contact with civilian society, he could hardly be said to have a corporate identity. He also acquired a new identity joining the army. And, you know, army parade discipline also gave him a new kind of identity, where he felt empowered, and he felt that he's empowered, and he felt that his identity as an East India Company soldier was the passport to upward mobility in his society. So this I have argued before, so I will not, for some year it will be repeating, but the Bengal sepoy, if he was fighting with the East India Company, he asserted his past as a peasant, asserted that he was also essentially a peasant. And if he was fighting his own society, he asserted the East India part of his of his identity. So a certain historian's notion that the Bengal sepoy was but a peasant in uniform is very, 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 very simplistic and cannot be taken, as far as I am concerned, cannot be accepted. So what I want to say is that, long and short of it, is that the Barakpur mutiny, if I say to take it as a local mutiny, was definitely not a sign of a long-term malaise in the East India Company. It was a short-term. Ishan, I will sum up in 5 minutes. Okay, is that okay? Yes, I will not bore. I will not bore people for that. So, what I am trying to argue here is that the Barakpur mutiny was definitely not a sign of long-term malaise. It was a short-term crisis where the sepoys' notion of justice had been hurt, but it was definitely nothing, not a sign of long-term malaise. If at all a long-term reason for 1857 have to be found, have to be searched for, it is the long-term can be only extend to 1 year. That is the period between 1856 and 1857. That is from the annexation of Awadh to the breakout of the mutiny in 1857 or the revolt. So as far as I am concerned, but anyway, these are topics on which a lot of people have dwelt, and I have dwelt, other historians have dwelt, and this, and if we need not go into them, 1857 has been extensively covered, and a lot of good work and bad work both happened post 2007. What I would say is that just one or two concluding lines, that what possibly needs to be done with regarding 1857 is first of all, how did this notion of it being a war of independence arise? Why do we remember 1857 as this epical moment in our freedom struggle? When did these notions gain ground? And maybe one could also go beyond Mangal Pandey as a movie, because there are other very good movies on 1857. Junoon, Shatranj Killari, not directly, but it's the backdrop. Junoon, Shyam Benegal's what is the serial? Bharat Ek Khoj, one episode. I cannot say that Moni Konika is a good movie. I just cannot, I'm sorry. I cannot say, and there is no personal bias here. So anyway, so to conclude, what I have tried to establish here is that military history is not just of the subcontinent, of the colonial times, it's not just the history of the army, it's not just a narrow history of the Indian Army. One needs to collaborate, one needs to connect with labor, the historians working on labor, historians working on caste, historians working on migration, historians working on colonial discourses, to write a more meaningful history of the Indian Army. I have no issue with people, a lot of people, especially in two maybe unlikely places, according to some, Jadavpur University and JNU have done very good work on the military. A lot of young scholars are doing very good work, and some of them are on a host of issues. But my entire objective is, as far as I am concerned, I do not have the expertise to write on strategies, tactics, and battles. Though campaign histories need not necessarily be narrow. Campaign histories can include a host of issues relating to the civilian society or to the parish society from which the army is hailing. Or let's say, when you are talking about battle, why are the men fighting? Why are the men fighting as a group? Why are they, where does the cohesion come from? You know, these are also issues on which people like Tarak al-Barawi and other historians, Martin Van Krevel, have worked. So, you know, it's rarely actually just military history. So that's all I would like to say, that we want to write a more meaningful history. One is that also to end that historians who work on labor, migration, or other issues also need not look down upon military history. Everything is connected. And to write more meaningful histories, we need to cooperate with each other, and write more meaningful and comprehensive histories. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for this very lucid presentation and for very, very brilliant lecture that you have presented this evening on Colonial Indian Army. We have two questions for you in the chat, and I'll read out to them to you. The first question is from Anirudh, Professor Anirudh Deshpande, sir, from Delhi University. And his question is, the Bengali male was considered effeminate by colonial ideology. Long before the martial races theory arose, the Purbaiyas had been recruited by the Zamindars of Bengal in their private militias as the Lathials. It seems usually they were feared by the poor peasants and tenants. So can it be said that a military preference for the Purbaiya antedates the martial race theory? Kolff speak of the Baksariyas in the medieval armies of India. So does Iktidar Alam Khan? Please shed some light on it.
No, I completely, Anirudh is my long, 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 long time friend and my well-wisher. So I completely agree with him because I also agree that this categorizing of the Bengali male as cowardly started long before the martial race. I think I also made that point, unless I was not clear that even when the Bengal army was recruiting in the 1750s or the 1760s, the Bengali male had already been categorized as non-martial. This is long before the martial race theory in the 1880s. Only difference is that from the 1880s, specifically the Bengali Babu is being categorized as cowardly. Whereas here in the 1750s, 60s, it's the Bengali in general who is being categorized as cowardly. Now coming to the Bengali Zamindars keeping Purbaiya Lathials, it is possible that the Bengalis themselves thought that they were cowardly or non-martial. That is possible. And I had once, somebody was presenting a paper on this Black Sunday where the company officers in Kolkata were afraid that the sepoys in 1857 would actually were coming to Calcutta, and they were in a panic. So I asked the correspondent that, I asked the paper presenter that, what about the Bengali Babus who usually kept the Purbaiyas as Lathials, and now there would be this Purbaiyas who are Biharis, and now these Purbaiyas would actually come and dance on their heads because they would now command the situation. What was their reaction? I got no answer. So I agree with Anirudh. I have no issue with that. And that is the point I also, I want to, in fact, Anirudh has given me certain clues. I want to see in the first place, how did these notions arise? Is it all just the martial race theory about climate, environment, political climate, environment, food, religion, you know, host of factors? Or is it also to go to do with the native perception, self-perception and native perception regarding each other? So that is, so I agree with him. I have no issues with his question. Who else?
The next question is from Shashwata Bhattacharya from Department of History, Vishwa Bharati. And his question is, can you say something on the foundation of the new garrison towns and formation of bazaar economy generally happened because of the migration of army as mentioned by C.A. Bailey? And how monetization increased with the movement of
my
army?
God.
And what were their ways of entertainment? That is a question from Shashwata Bhattacharya.
Ways of entertainment were many. Let me not specify everything here. And as far as bazaar economy is concerned, let me tell you that the company officers, when I was talking about, it's a very good question. I have taught him and maybe likely to teach him next semester. So it's a very good question. Firstly, I would try to congratulate him. The bazaar economy, when I was talking about the paternal officers at the, you know, the British in the initial stages trying to build up this entire thing about the paternal officer, the Maibab Sarkar. So some of the allowances, they were given 5,000 rupees bazaar allowances. 5,000 rupees bazaar allowances in 1760s is huge. These days, even today, we get 5,000 for Xerox in a year as a teacher, so maybe 10,000. So you can understand. So it's obvious that if there is a garrison somewhere near, then there is also this entire thing of the bazaars springing up and of money exchanging hands and of a lot of products. That's how I mean, Kanpur in the first place arose initially because as a garrison town, and the entire business, the garrison, you know, the presence of a garrison ended. So that is it. So entire these garrisons, cantonments also resulted in a lot of bazaars and springing up and a trade and a monetization of, and the trade means the exchange of cash.
Definitely. And we have one last question, sir, for this evening, and it is from Ravindra Hazari, and his question is, can you trace the influence of free British military heritage and cultures on the growth and development of three princely armies? Presidency army.
Thank God. Princely armies, if he had said, I would have said, I do not know. So, but he said presidency armies. Of course, you could say that as we are talking about the Anirudh, talked a little ago about the Buxar years. The Purbaiyas, and you could go back to Darkolf's book also, the Purbaiyas especially were recruited from areas which had a long tradition of military service. You know, the areas Buxar, Ara, this region had a long tradition. What was the company doing differently? They were ensuring that this supply of military labor, you could call military labor, is trying, or they're trying to ensure, is monopolized by them. That is, how did the month Kartik month, why is the month Kartik called Kartik? Because after harvest in this season, a lot of peasants used to go to serve as mercenary soldiers. So Kartik is the Hindu god of war, so that's how the Kartik come. So now what they were trying to do is that this supply of military labor, the British are trying to monopolize. They are trying to monopolize that only they shall get the best of the manpower. So obviously they are drawing from pre-British traditions, but they're trying to mold these traditions to their advantage. So that is what is happening. So they're obviously drawing on a lot of pre-British traditions. And I'm trying to argue or trying hazarding a guess that this entire categorizing of martial and non-martial had also to do to an extent with of communities as martial and non-martial, had to also to do with the extent with pre-British traditions and perceptions.
So if you allow this, one last question from Professor Deshpande, and his question is, how do you explain the scale of rebellion in the Bengal army only with reference to 1 year? Why was the mutiny so extensive and joined by the peasantry?
Okay, so I have to give another talk. I was, you know, when you told me that 1857, there's already been a talk, I was careful to avoid very few references to it. Okay, I first of all stick to my point that the things deteriorated between 1856 and 1857, because there are a lot of circumstantial evidences in the sense that between 1856 and 1857, after the annexation of Awadh, you see mysterious fires breaking out, then thatched roofs being suddenly getting burned off the Sahib's bungalows. Then officers who had gone on leave for a long time to England, when they came back, they saw that the sepoys were very, very sullen. And the sepoys crowding around telegraph and, you know, the telegraph had just come in, and post offices, as if there was some kind of news in the air. Manohar Malgonkar has written this book called The Devil's Wind or The Shaitani Hawa. So there was definitely something between 1856 and 1857. Now, because I have talked in multiple places about Rudrangshu Mukherjee's peasant in uniform and my notion about hybrid identity, I wanted to avoid it. But now that he has asked this question, I have no choice. Okay. Basically, it is true that obviously I have never denied that they had no links with the peasantry. What I'm trying to say is that the links with the peasantry should not be seen in a simplistic way. The Bengal army or the Bengal sepoy had what I say, a hybrid identity or multiple identities. As in, one part of him was still a peasant or connected with his peasant society, parent society, or with the peasant part of his identity. But military parade, drill, you know, fighting together, it also led him to acquire new identities. Now, when he was fighting his own society or trying to warm his way up his own society, he asserted the East India Company part of his identity. I am an East India Company soldier. When he had a fight with the East India Company, he asserted the peasant part of his country. I am also, you know, I also am a peasant. And the point is that that is why in 1857, his association, while he was fighting with the peasant, and because for tactical reasons, because both had the common enemy, his relationship with the native society or with the civilian society was very tension filled. As in all movements, some people fight together, work together, but they have the tension between them. There's a tension field. And there are, if you look at Delhi and other places, there are umpteen instances where the sepoys are coming in contact with the civilians, in conflict with the civilians. Now you could say that these things happen in war, but I would say that I would not put it down to just these things happen in war, because there is the, right from the 1820s to 1850s, sepoys are also constantly fighting. Though they have a contact with the peasant society, they're also fighting common peasants whom they're crushing at times and grabbing land. They are also fighting the zamindars. So why should we look at black and white? They are fighting with the peasants and the landed elite in 1857 because they have a common enemy. But while they're fighting together, they have also a tension between them. And the sepoys also look upon themselves as some kind of a new elite. In the sense, and the, this is reflected in the way they talk to the Sindhia Maharaja or to the Bahadur Shah Jafar, with the way the or to Rani of Jhansi for that matter. The assertiveness that they show is ironically they have rebelled against the East India Company, but the power, sense of power which they have derived from service in the East India Company and the knowledge that they are the best trained soldiers in the rebel camp, trained by the best army in the world against whom they have rebelled, gives them also a sense of power. So I do not look at things in black and white. Things are usually never in black and white. They are fighting together, which is undeniable. There was also a latent tension between them.
Thank you so much, sir, for taking out time to deliver this lecture and for answering all the queries that we got on Facebook Live. It was truly an honor to host you this evening to speak on such an important topic, the first in the series of military history lectures. Thank you so much, and we hope that we'll have you again on our platform soon.
Okay, thank you. It was an honor for me also, pleasure for me also. I hope I didn't bore people. So
no, not at all, sir. It was a very lucid presentation, a brilliant lecture.
Thank you.
It was a great pleasure for all of us to listen to you this evening.
Thank you. Hope to be back and keep going.
Thank you, sir. Bye. And our special thanks to all the viewers who watched us live this evening. And a very happy Basant Panchami to all. I forgot to wish you all in the beginning. So happy Basant Panchami to all. May Ma Saraswati bless us all with knowledge. Thank you so much, sir, and have a great evening.
Thank you. Same here. Bye.